In an event of an emergency, please use the exit behind you and head towards the stairs on your right. With that being done, sit back, enjoy the show, and take everything as you like it.
As I remember, it was upon this fashion bequeathed me by will, 1,000 crowns, and thou sayest, charge my brother on his blessing to greet me well. And there begins my sadness. My brother, Oliver, he keeps at school and reports speak goldenly of his profit. For my part, he keeps me rustically at home, or to speak more properly, keeps me here at home unkept. Recall you, but the gentleman, my birth that differs not from the schooling of ox. I, his own brother, gave nothing but growth. And this is the element that breeds me. And the spirit of my father, which I believe is within me, begins to mutiny against the servitude. I will no longer endure it. I see no wise remedy of how to avoid it.
You are to come for my master, your brother.
Go upon, Adam, that was the old shake me up.
Now, sir, what make you here?
Nothing. I'm taught not to make anything.
What mind you then, sir?
Marry, sir. I'm helping you to marvel which God made a poor unlearned brother of yours with idleness.
Marry, sir, be better employed, and we not a while.
Should I keep your hogs and eat husk with them? What prodigal portion have I spent to come to such penury?
Know you where you are, sir?
Oh, sir, very well, here in your orchard.
Know you before whom, sir?
I, better than I am those before me. I know you are my eldest brother, and in the gentle condition of blood you should know me. The courtesy of nations allows you my better, and that you are the firstborn. But the same tradition takes not away from my blood. I have as much of my father in me as you. Howbeit, I confess, you're coming before me as near as his reverence.
What, boy? Come, elder brother, you are too young in this.
Wilt thou lay hands on me, villain?
I am no villain. I am the youngest son of Sir Roland the Boys. He was my father, and he's thrice a villain that says such begot a villain. Wert thou not my brother, I will not take thy hand from thy throat without the other. Pulled out my tongue for saying so.
Masters, have patience, please. For your father's remembrance, be at our court.
Let me go, I say.
I will not, till I please. You shall hear me. My father left it to you to give me good education, and you have trained me like a peasant. The spirit of my father grows strong within me, and I will no longer endure it. Therefore, give me the poor lottery. My father left me 5 tetons, and with that I will go and buy my fortunes.
And what will that do? Beg when that is spent? Well, sir, get you in. I will not long be troubled with you. You shall have some part of your will. I pray you, leave me.
I'll no further offend you than it comes to my own good.
Get you with him, you old dog.
Is old dog my reward? It's true I have lost my teeth in your service. God be with your father. He would not have spoken with such a word.
Is it even so, begin you to grow up on me? Oh, physic your redness, and yet give no 1,000 crowns neither. Was not Charles, the Duke's wrestler, here to speak with me? So be of your way, and tomorrow the wrestling is. Come, wrestler!
Good morrow to your worship.
Good morning to you, Charles. What's the new news of the new court?
There's no news of court, sir, but the old news. That is, the old Duke is banished by his younger brother, the new Duke, and 3 or 4 loving lords have put themselves into voluntary exile.
Will you know if Rosalind, the Duke's daughter, be banished with her father?
Oh no, sir. For the Duke's daughter, her cousin so loves her, she would have followed her exile, or have died to stay behind her. She's at the court.
Where will the old Duke live?
They say he's already in the Forest of Ardern, and there are a great many merry men with him. And there they live like the old Robin Hood of England.
What, you wrestle tomorrow before the new Duke?
Marry do I, sir. And I came to acquaint you with the matter. I am given, sir, secretly to understand that your younger brother Orlando hath a disposition to come in disguise against me to try a fall. Tomorrow, sir, I wrestle for my credit, and he that escapes me without some broken limb shall acquit him well. I would be loath to foil him, as I must, for my own honour if he come in. Therefore, out of my love to you, I came hither to acquaint you with all, that either you might stay him from his intent, or brook such disgrace well as he shall run into, in that it is a thing of his own search, and altogether against my will.
Charles, I thank thee for thy love to me, which thou shalt find a most kindly requite. I have myself notice of my brother's partners herein, and have by underhand means laymen to dissuade him from it. But he is resolute. I'll tell thee, Charles, he is the stubbornest young fellow of France, a secret and villainous retriever against me, his natural brother. Therefore use thy discretion. I had as lief thou didst break his neck as a finger, I assure thee. And with almost tears I speak it, there is not one so young and so villainous this day living. I speak but brotherly of him, but should I anatomize him to thee as he is, I must blush and weep, and thou must be pale and warm enough.
I'm heartily glad I came hither to you, sir. If he come tomorrow, I'll give him his payment. And if ever he go alone again, I'll never wrestle for prize more, and so God keep your worship.
Farewell, good Charles. Farewell, Charles. Now will I stir this gamester. I hope to see an end of him. For my soul, I yet know not why, hates nothing more than him. Well, not long now. This wrestler shall clear all. Nothing remains but I kindle the boy thither, which now I'll go about.
Stand you both forth now, stroke your chins and swear by your beards that I'm a knave.
By our beards? If we had them, thou art.
By my knavery, if I had it, then I would. But if we swear by that is not, we are not forsworn. No more was this knight swearing by his honour, for he never had any. For if he had, he had run away long before he saw those pancakes, or that mustard.
Prithee, who is that loveliness?
One that old Frederick, your father loves.
My father's love is enough to honour him. Enough! Speak no more of him. There'll be a whipped taxation on these days.
The more pity that fools may not speak wisely what wise men do foolishly. Oh,
why my troth thou sayest true? For since little wits that from some of silence, little foolery the wise that hath makes a great show. Oh, he wins not to the bow.
So desirous to lie with his mother earth.
Ready, sir. It's half will make it to more mother's working.
You shall try. What for?
Adopted heir to Frederick. My father loves Sir Rowland as his soul, and all the world to in treaties, and you thus have left them.
Yep. Gentle cousin, let us go thank him and encourage him. My father's rough and envious disposition sticks me hard. Sir!
You have well deserved. If you do keep your promises in love, as we've exceeded all promise, your mistress shall be happy.
Gentlemen, where is for me? Well, out of suits with fortune that would give more, but that her hand lacks means. Shall we go, cousin?
Aye, very well.
There again, I will say thank you. Under the right better parts all thrown down. Here the remains, but to me it was quaint and luscious look.
He calls us back. If I fell with my fortunes, I'll ask him what else did you call, sir?
Sir, you have wrestled well and overcome more than just your enemies.
Will you go with us?
I'm with you. He's going to speak.
Someone.
Can I tell you well?
What passion hangs and sweats upon my tongue? I cannot speak to her, yet she urged conference. Oh,
poor Orlando, thou art overthrown!
Or Charles, or something weaker masters thee!
My gentle friendship counsel you from this place, albeit you have deserved high commendation, true applause and love, yet such is now the Duke's condition, that he misconstrued all that you've done.
I thank you, my pray you tell me this. Which one too was the daughter of the Duke that was here wrestling?
Well, neither his daughter for judge by manners, but yet indeed the lesser is his daughter. The other's daughter to the banished Duke, and here detained by holy serving, uncle to keep his daughter company, becomes a dearer than the natural one of his sisters.
I rest much fire on you. Fare ye well.
Thus must I from smirking to smother, from tyrant Duke unto a tyrant brother.
But heavenly!
Rosalind!
Why, cousin? Why, Rosalind?
Give it a mercy.
Not a word?
Not one to throw at a dog.
No, thy words are too precious to be cast upon curse. Come, throw some at me.
Name me with reasons. There's never two cousins made up. One named with reasons, and the other man without any.
But is all this your fault?
Let it suffice me that I trust
stay?
It was your pleasure, to your own rules. I was too young at that time to value her, but now that I know her, if she betrays her, so am I. Still, we have stuck together. Rose at the instant, learn, play, act together, and that's the rubber we went, like Juno Swans, so we went coupled, and then separated.
You are a fool! She robs thee of thy name! Thou wilt shine more bright and see more virtues when she is banished!
Pronounce that sentence for me, my liege. I cannot live without her company.
You are a fool! You, cousin, provide yourself. Thou art stuck outseeing the tables then. Upon my honour, upon the graciousness of my word, you die!
Upon my body, I smile and say, this is no flattery. these are cancers that feel you to be what I am. I will not change it.
Happy is your grace that can translate the stubbornness of fortune to so quiet and so sweet a star.
Come, drink your careless medicine.
Yeah, it hurts me, those poor dappled fools. They've diverged from the stairs at St. Each. Then their own confines shall have their round torches born.
Indeed, my lord, the melancholy shakeweed proves of that, and in that kind swears you do more use to than doth your brother that hath banished you. Today, my lord of Amiens and myself did steal behind him as he lay along under an oak, whose antique prince peeps out upon the brook that draws along this wood, to that which place a poor sequestered stag that from the hunter's aid had taken a hurt did come to languish. And indeed, my lord, the wretched animal heaved forth such groans that its discharge did stretch its leathern coat almost to bursting, and big round tears coursed one another down its innocent nose in piteous chase. And thus the hairy fool, much marked as the melancholy jade queen, stood on the extremest verge of the swift brook, tormenting it with tears.
But what said jade queen? Did not moralize the spectacle?
Oh yes, into a thousand similes. First, for its weeping into the needless stream. Oh, poor dear, quoth he, thou makest a testament, as worldlings do, giving thy sum of more to that which is too much. Ay, quoth he, sweep on, you fat and greasy citizens, 'tis just the fashion. Wherefore do you look upon that poor and broke bankrupt there? Thus, most invectively, he pierceth through the body of this country, city, courtier, and of this high own lives, stating that we are mere usurpers, tyrants, and what's worse, to fright and kill the animals in their assigned and native dwelling places.
And did you leave him in this hospital?
We did, my lord, weeping and commenting upon the solemn fit.
Show me the face, for I love to cope him when he's in these sullen fits. Then he is full of matter. I'll show you to him straight.
Some low content.
Go on, master, and I will follow thee to last gasp. with truth and loyalty, for fortune cannot recompense me better than to die well and not my master's debtor.
Keep
your distance. My
master,
a hug?
Just a handshake. Fortune, how weary my spirits.
I care not for my spirits if my legs were not weary.
I could find it in my heart to disgrace my man's apparel and cry like a woman, but I must comfort the weaker vessels. As doublet and hose must show itself courageous to petticoat. Therefore, courage, good Eliana. I pray you bear with me. Cannot go any further.
For my part, I'd rather bear with you than bear you. Yet, I should bear no cross. I did bear you, for I think you have been learning your goods.
You don't get paid. Well, this is the Forest of Ardern.
Aye, now am I an Ardern? The more fool I. When I was at home, I was in a better place, but oh, the travellers must be content.
Aye, be so, good Touchstone. Look, here comes a young man and an old in solemn talk. That is the way to make us spawn.
Oh, Corin, that how new is we do love her.
Partly, yes, for I'm glad to hear now.
No, Corin, being old, thou canst not guess that in thy youth thou wasn't true love that ever sighed upon a midnight pillow. But if thy love were ever a light to mine, I'm sure it would be never a man loved so. How many actions most ridiculous hast thou been drawn to by thy fantasy?
Into a thousand? I have forgotten.
Thou wast a mere lust so hardly. If thou rememberest not the slightest folly that love did ever make thee run into, thou wast not loved. Or if thou wast not broken company as abruptly as my passion now makes thee, thou wast not loved, and Phoebe, Phoebe.
Such was thy adventure. I have my
hand
going to
found
my own.
We are true lovers when strange papers, but as all is mortal in nature, so is all nature in love and mortal in love.
Thou speakest wiser than thou art aware of.
Nay, I shall never be aware of my own wit till I break my shins against it.
Joe, this shepherd's passion is much upon my fashion.
And mine, but it grows something stale.
I pray you, bear with me. One of you question yon man, eat for gold, and give us any fruit. I faint almost to death.
Holla, you clown.
A peaceful, he's not thy kinsman.
You're better, sir.
I'll be on very wretched.
Peace. Good even to you, friend, and to you, gentle love. Sir, and to you all. I pray you, if that love or gold can in this desert place by entertainment bring we us where we may rest ourselves and sleep, here's a young maid. We've travelled much oppressed and the faints.
Fair sir, I pity her, and wish for her sake more than my own. My fortunes are more able to rule her. I do not cheer the feasts that I praise.
My master is a churlish disposition, and little recks by the way to my time, do indeed hospitality. By reason of his actions, there is nothing here that you will feed on, but what is conceived, and in my words most welcome shall it be. Who is that shall buy his flock and pasture?
That young swain you saw here for ill us, but little cares for our anything.
I pray you, if it stands in honesty, buy thou the flock and pasture of us, and you will have to pay for it of us.
Oh, I like one.
And
we will mend thy wages.
Oh!
I like this place, and willingly waste my time.
Ah, the soil, the profit, this kind of life. I would have very faithful feed of me. I'm paid with your gold, right, Sullivan.
you, young Mary.
A fool, a fool. I met a fool in a forest. A motley fool. Miserable world. As I delivered my food, I met a fool. Who lay down and basked in the sun, and bullied on good lady's terms. In good set terms, and yet a motley fool. A good morrow fool, quoth I. No, sir, quoth he. Call me not fool till heaven hath sent me fortune. And then he drew a dial from his poke, and looking on it with lacklustre eyes, says very wisely, it is 10 o'clock, thus we may see. Since it was an hour ago, since it was 9, and in another hour, it will be 11, and so from hour to hour, we ripe and ripe, and hour to hour, we rot and rot, and thereby hangs a tale. A noble fool, a worthy fool, a motley's the only wear.
What fool is this?
A worthy fool, a one that hath been a courtier, he swears, which he vents in magical observations. Oh, but I were a fool, I am ambitious of a motley coat.
I shall have one, yes.
It shall be my only suit, provided that you need your better judgments for all that I rank in them. That I am wise. I must have liberty, withal, as large a charter as the wind, to blow on whom I please, for so forth have. And they the most gallied with my folly, they most must laugh. Invest me in my motley, give me leave to speak my mind, and I will, through and through, cleanse the foul body of this infected world, if they will patiently receive my medicine.
Fie on thee, I know what thou wouldst do.
What, for a canter? Would I do no good?
Most mischievous and highly, for thou thyself hast been a liberty as sensual as the British state itself.
Why the contact any private party? Doth it not flow as hugely as the sea till that the very, very weary means to end? But who comes here?
Back! Forbear! And eat no more!
Why have we gone here?
Well, nor shall not to unless it be served!
What kind should this fuck come of?
Thou both hast boldened man by thy distress, or else have brewed despised with manners that is civility. Thou seemest so empty.
Well, you've touched my vein at first. The fawning point of bare distress have taken from me the show of smooth civility. Yet I am in the bread and know some nurture. But forbear, I say! The he that dies, whoever touches this food, and my affairs are answered.
And you will not be answered with reason. For I must die.
What must thou have? Your gentlemanship of false morning and fortune moves gentleness.
I almost died for food, and let me have it.
Sit down and eat, and welcome to our table.
Speak you so gently. Pardon me, I pray, forbear your food a little while, whilst, like a doe, I go and fetch my fawn. There is an old, poor man, who with many weary steps limped through the door dust since his first piece of fight. Oppressed with 2 weak evils, age and hunger, and will not touch bed.
Come seek him out. We will nothing waste until.
Thank you. That's your good comfort.
You're not all alone and happy. This wide universal gift presents more woeful a pageant than the scene we're in pain.
All the slaves, and all the men and women, lady players, they have their entrances and their exits. One man in his time plays many parts, his act being of 7 ages. First, the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. And then, the schoolboy, with satchel and shining morning face, creeping like a snail unwillingly to school. Then the lover, sighing like a furnace, with a woeful ballad made to his mistress's eyebrow. Then the soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the pard. Jealous in honour, sudden and quick to quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth. Then there's the justice, in bare round belly with good camp on line, with eyes severe and beard of formal cut, full of wise sores in modern instances. And so he plays his part. The sixth age shifts into the lean and slippered pantaloon, with spectacles on nose and pouch on side. His youthful hopes well saved, world too wide for his shrunk shank. And his big, manly voice, turning slowly towards childish trebles, pipes and whistles in his sounds. The last scene of all that ends this is a strange and eventful history. His second childishness a mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything.
Well, set down
your
venerable
beard
and
a letter
feet.
I thank you most for him.
So much you need, I scarce can speak to thank you for my soul.
Welcome, Fulton. I will not trouble you as yet to question you about your fortunes. Let us have some music and good cousin. Sing.
Blow, blow, thou wind, thou art not so unkind as man's ingratitude. Thy tooth is not so keen because thou art not seen, although thy breath be rude. Hi-ho, sing, hi-ho, unto the great awning. Most friendship is feigning, most loving mere folly. Then hi-ho, the hardy. This life is most jolly.
Thank you. Woo!
Shepherd? You have too
cool ear wit
for me, old
rat. Let us stand! God, I'll be your shallow man.
Don't make decisions with me. Thou art raw. Thou art
fucking raw!
Oh, here comes young Master Gandhi, my new magician father. From the east to west of it, no jewel is like Rosalind. Her love being mounted on the wind through all the world, fair Rosalind. All but pictures, fairest line, are but black Rosalind. Let no fair be kept in mind but the fair of Rosalind.
I'll arrive you so 8 years together, all dinners and suppers and sleeping hours accepted. It is the right letter when he's ranked to market.
Out of all.
For a taste. If a heart do like a hind, let him seek out Rosalind.
What?
If the cat will after kind, so be sure will Rosalind.
Oh, gorgeous.
Winter garments must be lined, so must slender Rosalind. They that breed must sheep and vine, then to cart with Rosalind.
Excellent.
Sweetest lad, that star is right, such as that is. Rosalind. Love's whose wood must find love's prick. And Rosalind.
Many. Gorgeous.
These are the very most gallant verses. Why do you infect yourself?
Peaceful. I found them on a tree.
Truly the tree yields bad fruit.
I'll graft it with you, and then I will graft it with a medlar, and then it'll be the earliest fruit in the country, because you'll be rotten and you'll be half ripe. And that is bright birch from the medlar.
You've said, but better wise than know the forest still.
Peace. Here comes my sister, reading. Why should this be desert be? Let her. It is unpeopled. No. Tongues are hanged on every tree that shall civil saying show. Some, how brief the life of man runs his errand pilgrimage, and the stretching of a span backwards in the sun age. Some are violated vows twixt the soul of friend and friend, but upon the fairest vows, for at every sentence end, will I, Rosalind, write, teaching all that we to know the quintessence of Everton's bright heaven wouldn't it have shown. Heaven we see these pictures have. And I to live and die her slave.
Oh, most gentle polygon. What tedious comedy of love have you wearied your commercialism with all? And never cry, have patience, good people.
How now? Back friends, shepherd, come off little. Go with him.
Let's make an honourable retreat. Not with bag and baggage, yet with script and scrippage.
Did Sam hear these verses?
Yes, and more too, for some of them had in them more feet than the verses would bear.
That's no matter, the feet might bear the verses.
The feet were lame, and could not bear themselves without the verses, and therefore stood lame in the verse.
But didst thou hear that, wondering how, thy name could be penned and carved upon you?
I was 7 of the 9 days of wonder before you came. But look here, what I found on a palm tree. I was never so
He was banished like a high
ominous.
Oh, you're kidding
me. To kill my heart.
I would sing my song without a burden. Now bring it me out of tune.
What's not now, no? I have a woman. What I think I must speak. Sweet. Say on.
You bring me out. Soft.
How is he not here?
Tis he, sleep by the motor.
I thank thee for your company, but for faith I have you to be myself alone.
And so had I, but yet, the fashion faith, I thank you for your society.
May God be with you. Let's meet as little as we can.
I do desire we may be better strangers.
I pray you, mar no more trees of writing love songs in their bar.
I pray you, mar no more of bringing them ill-favoredly.
Rosalind is your last name?
Yes, just.
I do not like her name.
Ha!
There was a report of pleading you when she was christened.
What stature is she of?
Just as high as my heart.
Oh, you are full of pretty answers.
Well.
Ha!
Sir, I have grown weary of you.
By troth, I was seeking for a fool when I found you.
He was drowned in the brook. Look, my tenant, you shall see him.
There I shall see my own figure.
Which I take to be either a fool or a cipher.
I'll tarry with you no more. Farewell, good. It's in your love.
I'm glad of your departure. The dear, good monsieur, men of the lead.
I will talk to him like a saucy lassie and play the name with him. Do you hear, Forester?
Very well. What would you?
I pray you, what is o'clock?
It's just what time of day it is. There's no clock in the forest.
Then, what time is it? There is no true lover in the forest.
What time is it?
Or else sighing every minute and groaning every hour would detect the lazy foot of time as well as the clock.
Where dwell you, pretty youth?
With this shepherdess, my sister, here in the forest, like fringe upon a petticoat.
Are you native of this place?
As the pony you see here dwell where she is kindled.
But why so is something finer that could be purchased in such a rude dwelling?
I have been told so of many, but indeed, an old religious uncle of mine taught me to speak, who was in his youth an inland man. One that knew courtship too well for there, he fell in love. I have heard him read many lectures against it, and I thank God I am not a woman like to be taxed with so many offences as he has generally taxed their whole sex with all.
Can you recount any of the principal evils that you laid charge to the woman?
They were not principal. They were all alike as halfpenny are. Every one thought seeming monstrous till his fellow fault came to match it.
I think you recount some of them.
Nay, I will not recount my visit, but on those that are still. There is a young man haunts this forest with carving Rosalind on their bars. Hangs oaths upon it, hawthorns and elegies on brambles, all forsooth, defying the name of Rosalind. If I could meet that fancy monger, I should give him good counsel, for he seems to have the quotidian of love upon him. That is a good one. That there will not be one spot of love in it.
be cured you.
I would cure you. If you would but call me Rosalind and come to my pot every day and remove me.
With all my heart, tell me where it is.
Go with me to it. And by the way, tell me where in the forest you live.
Very well, pretty youth.
Then. I am not a slut, though I thank the gods I am foul.
Well,
Praise be the gods that I found. Sluttishness may come hereafter, but be as it may be, I will marry thee. Which is why to that end I've been with Sir Oliver Martext, the vicar of the next village, and promised to meet me in this place of the forest and to cover us.
Here comes Sir Oliver. Sir Oliver Martext, you are well met. So you dispatch us here in the district, or shall we go with you to your chapel?
Is there none here to give away?
I will not take your own gift of any man.
Truly, she must be given, or the marriage is not lawful. Naughty boy.
Proceed, I'll give her.
Who the fuck is this? Good even, good master, what do you call it? How do you, sir? Very glad to see you. You've got a toy in hand here soon. Hey, great. Be covered.
Will you be married, Motley?
As the ox hath his bow, the horse his curb, and the falcon his bell, so man hath his desire.
Will you be a man of your breeding? Be married under a bush like a beggar? Eat a church and have a good priest to tell you what marriage is?
I'm not to mind, but I'd rather marry of him than of another, for he's not like to marry me well, and being not well married, you can excuse your after me to leave my wife.
Go with me and I will counsel thee.
Come, sweet Audrey. We must be married, or we must live in poetry. Farewell, good Master Oliver. Not, oh sweet Oliver, oh brave Oliver, leave me not behind thee, but wind away. Begone, I say, I will not do wedding with thee.
Tis no matter. No fantastical name of them all shall fall out to me out of my glory.
As ever may be near, you meet us so far.
fresh cheek the power of fancy, then you shall know the wounds invisible that love's gain our make.
Till that time, come thou near me, and when that time comes, pitch me not a thick new by moss, as till that time I shall not pity thee.
And why, I pray you, who might be your mother that you insult, exalt, and all at once over the wretched? What though you have no beauty, as by my faith I see no more in you than without candle, make your dark to bed. What means this? Why do you look on me?
Excuse me, I pray you try to meet together, for I would rather that you trust this kind of room.
He's fallen in love with her foulness, and she will fall in love with my anger. If it be so, as fast as she answers thee with triangle looks, I'll sauce her with bitter words. Why do you look on me?
No ill will I bear you.
I pray you, do not fall in love with me. I am falser than vows made in wine. Besides, I like you not. If you will know my house, 'tis at the Touchstone of olives here hard by. Come, sister!
Yeah.
Shepherd, ply her hard.
Will you go, sister?
Yeah. Shepherdess, look on them better, and be not proud, though all the world can see none can be so abused in sight as he. Sister, yes, and you, come here.
Then, shepherd, you might find my sword mighty, and the love not at first sight.
Sweetie!
What is thou, Octavius?
Sweet Phoebe! Oh, pity me!
I am sorry for thee, gentle Silvius.
Forever sorrow waits relief with thee. If you do sort my grief in love, then by giving love your sorrow and my grief with both exterminate.
Thou hast my love, is not that neighborly?
I would have you!
Why that were coming, Miss Silvius. Time that I hated thee, now it's not that I bear thee love. But since thou canst talk of love so well, thy company was irksome to me, but I shall endure it. I will call you to me. Do not look for further recompense, but I am very proud of what I have.
So holy and so perfect is my love, and I in such poverty of grace, shall think of the most plenteous crop to glean in the broken ears after the man the main harvest reaps. Lose thou then a scattered smile, and that I will live upon.
Does
that
mean that you expect me a while?
Not very well, but I have met off. You bought the cottage and the bounds of the old Carl was once master of.
Think not I love him, though I ask for him. 'Tis but a peevish boy, he talks well. But what cares I for words? It words too well when he that speaks them pleases those that hear. 'Tis a pretty youth, not very pretty, and sure he's proud, and yet quite more handsome. The best thing in him is his complexion, and faster than his tongue did make offence as I did heal it up. There'd be someone with Sylvia, if they marked him as I did, would be close to falling in love with him, but it is not that I love him, nor that I hate him. Yet I have more reason to hate him than to love him. For who is he to chide at me? He said mine eyes were black and my hair black, and I am scorned at, remembered me. I marvel why I answered not again. Admit it is no quittance. I shall write a very short letter, and now we'll wear it, right, my son, yes?
Phoebe, with all my heart.
The matter's in my head and in my heart. I'll write it straight. I'll be passing short and bitter. Come with me, Silvius.
I pray thee, pretty youth, and be better acquainted with thee.
They say you are a melancholy fellow.
I am so. I do love it better than laughing.
Those that are in extremity of either are abominable fellows, and betray themselves to every censure worse than drunkards.
Well, 'tis good to be sad and say nothing.
Why then, 'tis good to be a fool.
I have neither the scholar's melancholy, which is emulation, and nor the musician's, which is fantastical. But it is a melancholy of my own, compounded of many symbols, of many objects, and indeed the sundries contemplations of my travels, which indeed my often rumination wraps me in a most humorous sadness.
A traveller! You have great reason to be sad. I fear you have sold your lands to see other men's, to have seen much and have nothing, is to have rich eyes and poor hands.
Oh,
yes, I have my experience gained.
Oh, good day and happiness, dear Rosalind.
May this fool return. Oh, God be with you. And you talk in a blind blur.
Farewell, not to your traveller. Why, how now, Orlando? Where have you been all this while?
Oh, my fair Rosalind, I come within an hour of my promise.
Freaking hours, promise. In love. He will that will divide a minute into a thousand parts and break but a part of the 1,000th part of a minute in the affairs of love. Well, it may be said that Cupid has clapped him over the shoulder, but I'll warrant his heart whole.
Pardon me, dearest.
Nay, and you being so tardy, I had a sleepy wound of a snail.
Of a snail?
Yes, of a snail. For though he comes slowly, he carries his house on his back. A better jointure, I think, than you, pretty woman. Besides, he carries his fortune with him.
What? And what's that?
Horse, which Hans Leaf been providing to your woman for. For he carries his fortune on his back and prevents the slander of his wife.
Virtue is no whoremaker, and my Rosalind is virtuous.
And I am your Rosalind. It pleases him to call you so, but he hath a Rosalind of a better weird than it.
Oh!
Oh, Ruby, for now I have been a holiday through us. And like enough to consent, what would you say to me now as I am your very, very Rosalind? Oh.
I would kiss before I spoke.
Whoa! Whoa! No!
Nay, you would better speak first. And when you have raveled for lack of matter, you might take occasion to kiss. Very good orators, for when they spit for lovers lacking, God warn us the cleanliest shit in this kiss.
How has this kiss been denied?
Then she puts you to entreaty, and then begins a new matter.
Out, being before his beloved mistress.
That should you, or else I should think my honesty ranker than my wit.
What? Of my suit?
Not out of your power. Yes, out of your suit. Am I not your Rosalind?
No, I take some joy to say you are, because I've been talking of her.
Well, in her hands, I say I will not have you.
I will not have my right Rosalind as mine, for I protest have found my kill me.
Well, in this hand, I will not. But come now, I will be your Rosalind in all coming on this position. Ask me what you will, I will grant it.
Then love me, Rosalind!
Yes! No! For I am ready for Saturday morning.
And wilt thou have me?
No. Yes, and 20 such.
What sayest thou?
Are you not good?
I hope so.
Can one have too much of a good thing? But come, sister! You bitch. You will be the priest and marry us. Give me your hand, Orlando.
Marry
Shush!
Us.
I cannot say the
you
word.
I'll begin.
Will you?
Go to. Will you, Orlando, have to wife this Rosalind?
I will.
Oh my God!
I will
when?
Why
well,
now? Ask if she can marry
then
us.
Then you must say the words. I take thee, Rosalind.
I take thee, Rosalind, for wife.
And I do take thee, Orlando, for husband. There's a girl goes before the priest, and certainly a woman's thoughts run before her actions.
So do all fools, they are winged.
But tell me, how long would you have her after you possess her?
Forever and a day.
Say a day without the ever. No, Orlando. Men are April when they woo, and December when they are wed. Maids are May when they are maids, but the sky changes when they are wives. And I will do that when you are inclined to be married. I will laugh on the high end, and that's when you are inclined to sleep.
Will my Rosalind do so?
By my life, she will do as I do.
Oh, but she is wise.
Or else she could not have the wit to do this. The wise are the way with her. Shut the doors on a woman's wit. Out of the casement. Stop that! Pull out of the keyhole! Stop that! Pull
have to excuse that.
She came to seek you there. You will never take her without her answer, unless thou take her without her tongue. If a woman cannot make her fault of her husband's occasion, let her never nurse her child herself. She will breed it like a fool.
For these 2 hours, Rosalind, I must leave thee.
Yes, I will not last me 2 hours.
Well, I must attend the Duke at dinner. By 2 o'clock, I'll be with thee again.
I knew what you would prove. My friends told me as such, and I thought no less, but that flattering tongue of yours won me. 'Tis but one cast away. And so come death. Two o'clock is your hour.
Oh, oh, sweet Rosalind! And if that's no religion, if thou were mine, Rosalind. So, adieu.
Well, time is of justice that examines all such offenders. And let time try. Adieu. Bye.
You have simply misused our sex in your love trade. We must have your dull little hair knocked over your head, show the world the bird.
Oh, cause! Oh my cause, 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 my beautiful cause. Dost thou know how many fathoms deep I am in love? My affection hath an unknown bottom, like the Bay of Portugal,
or rather bottomless. That expanses you pour affection in, it runs out.
No! That same bastard of Venus that was begot of thought, conceived of speed and born of madness. That same rascally boy that abuses everyone's eyes because his own are out. Let him be the judge of how deep I am in love. Tell the Aliena I cannot be out of the sight of Orlando. I'll go find a shadow and spitefully come. I'll sleep. How now? Is it not past 2 o'clock? I hear not Orlando.
I warrant thee. Troubled brain. He had taken his bow and arrows and is gone forth to sleep.
Not everyone sleeps.
Who was trying to do that? Hey, look who comes here. Who is this? Who are you?
My errand is to you, fair youth. My gentle Phoebe bid me give you this. I know not the contents, but as I guess for thee. Was fish action she did use as she was writing of it. Here's an angry tenor. Pardon me, but I'm just the guiltless messenger.
If the scorn of your bright eye hath power to
I'll go my ways. Oh, well, here comes more company. I'm really sorry. That's unbelievable.
You bastards!
You deserve that. That was really mean.
Good morning, fair ones. Pray you, if you know, where in the purlieus of this forest stands a sheep who fenced a valley of olive trees.
West of this place, down in the neighbour bottom, the rank of oats is back on that stream, left on your right hand, brings us to this place. Best place I ever have to keep itself. It's none within.
If and I may profit by a tongue, then I should name by description such garments and such years. The boy is famous, the female favour, and bestows herself like a ripe sister, the woman low and round than her brother. Are not you the owner of the house that I inquire for?
It is no ghost being asked, save
to the path. Orlando doth commend him to you both, and to the youth he calls his Rosalind, he sends this bloody napkin. Are you here?
I am. What must we understand by this?
Some of my shame, if you'll know of me what man I am, and how and why and where this handkerchief is stained.
I pray you to take it.
When last the young Orlando parted from you, he made a promise to return again. Within an hour, pacing through the forest, chilling on the food of sweet and bitter fantasy. Lo, what befell! Through his eye aside, and marked what object did present itself. Under an oak whose boughs were mossed with age and high-top bulk of dry antiquity, a wretched, ragged man, overgrown with hair, lay sleeping on his back. About his neck, a green and guilded snake had wreathed itself, who, with nimble threats, approached the opening of his mouth. When suddenly, seeing Orlando, it unlinked itself, and, with intended glides, did slip away into a bush, under which bushes shade a lioness, with udders all drawn dry, lay couching head on ground with cat-like watch. If that the sleeping man should stir, it's his the royal disposition of that beast shall prey on nothing that doth seem as dead. Having seen this, Orlando did approach the man and found it to be his brother, his elder brother.
Oh, I've heard him kill that same brother. He did render him the most unnatural of little ones found.
And well, he might so do, for I know he was unnatural.
But to Orlando, did he leave him there? Food to the such and hungry lioness?
Twice did he turn his back and propose so, but kindness nobler ever than revenge, and nature sweeter than his just occasion, made him give battle to the lioness. We quickly fell before him, in which hurtling from miserable slumber I awake.
Are you his brother?
What's you he rescued?
What's you that so oft contrived to kill him?
T'was I, but tis not I. I do not shame to tell you what I was, since my conversion so sweet tastes, being the thing I am.
But for the blood napkin?
By and by, when from the first to the last two betwixt us two tears our recumbents so kindly bathed, is how I came to that desert place. In brief, he led me to the gentle Duke, who gave me fresh array and entertainment, committing me into my brother's love. He led me instantly into this cave, there stripped himself, and on his arm, the lioness had torn some flesh away, which all this while had bled, and he fainted and cried, in fainting, upon Rosalind. In brief, I recovered him, bound up his wound, and, after some small space, being strong at heart, I came hither, strange as I am, to tell this story, that you might expose his broken promise, and give this napkin, dyed in his blood, to the shepherd youth he had conquered.
What? Why, how that can you meet? Sweet Ganymede!
Many will soon make you look on blood.
There's more to it. Cousin Ganymede!
Look, he recovers.
Show us over at home. I will lead you further. I pray you, will you take him by the arm?
Be of good cheer, youth. You are mad. You lack a man's heart.
I do so, I confess it. Ah! Sirrah, yes. I thought you would think this was well counterfeited. I pray you tell your brother how well I counterfeited to swoon. Show the napkin, hey ho!
was not counterfeit. There is too great testimony in your complexion that it was a passion of earnest.
Counterfeit! I assure you, really.
Well then, be of good heart and counterfeit me a man.
I do. But
in
faith, I should have been a woman. By right.
Come, look paler and paler, pray you will draw your woman's good sir, go with us.
I will, for I must bear answer back. How you excuse my brother?
But I pray you commend my counterfeiting to him.
Okay. Oh, what are you doing?
Is it so that on so little acquaintance you should like her, and that you should love her, and loving woo, would you grant her to preserve her?
Neither call the giddiness in question, the poverty of her sudden acquaintance, my sudden wooing, nor her sudden consenting. But sing with me, I love Alina. Say with her that she loves me. Consent that we may enjoy each other. It will be for your good, for my father's house and all the revenue that is under Sir Roland, will I estate upon you, and here live by a shepherd.
You have my consent. Let your wedding be tomorrow, and I'll invite the Duke and all his followers. Go, prepare for Alina. But look, here comes my Rosalind.
Good morning, brother.
And you first, sister.
Orlando, how it grieves me to see you wear thy heart in a scarf.
It's my arm.
I thought thy heart had been wounded with the claws of a lion.
Wounded with tears, but with the eyes of a lady.
Did your brother tell how I counterfeited to swoon when he showed the hand?
Dying greater wonders than that.
Oh, nay, I know where you are. 'Tis true. Your brother and my sister no sooner met, but they looked. So no sooner looked, but they loved. They are in the very wrath of love. Clubs cannot part them.
We shall be married tomorrow, and I'll attend the Duke and all his nuptials. Oh, how bitter a thing is to look through another man's eyes with happiness. By tomorrow I shall be the height of heart's heaviness. To knowing what my brother might wish for.
When then tomorrow I cannot serve your turn for Rosalind. I will weary you then no longer with idle talking. Know of me then, for now I speak to some good purpose, that I know you are a gentleman of good conceit. I say this not that you should have a good opinion of my knowledge, insomuch I say I know you are. Neither do I labor for a greater esteem that may in some little measure draw a belief from you to do yourself good and not to grace me. Believe me, then, if you please, I can do strange things. I have, since I was 3, conversed with a magician, most profound in his art and yet not damnable. If you do love Rosalind so near to the heart as your jester cries it out, when your brother marries Aliena, shall you marry her? I know what straits of fortune she is driven, and it is not impossible to me, if it appear not inconvenient to you, to set her before your eyes tomorrow, alive as she is, and without any danger.
Speakest thou in so meanings?
By my life I do, which I tender dearly, though I say I am a magician. So, put you in your best way, and bid your friends, for if you shall be married tomorrow, you shall, and to Rosalind, if you will. Yes. Look, here comes a lover of mine and a lover of hers.
You don't need much own gentleness to show the letter that I've written to you.
I care not if I have. It is my study to seem despiteful and ungrateful to you. You are here followed by a faithful shepherd. Look on him, love him. He worships you.
Good shepherd, tell us you what is to love.
Is to all be made of sighs and tears, and so am I for Phoebe.
So am I for Danny.
And so am I for Rosalind.
And so am I for no woman.
Well, is to all be made of faith and service, and so am I for Phoebe.
So am I for Danny.
And so am I for Rosalind.
And so am I for no woman.
Oh, it is all made of fantasy, all made of passion, all made of wishes, all adoration, duty and observance, all humbleness, all patience and impatience, all purity, all trial, all observance, and so am I for Phoebe.
So am I for Jamie.
And so am I for Rosalind.
So am I for no woman.
This be so, why blame me to love you?
If this be so, why blame you me to love you?
If this be so, why blame me to love you?
Who do you speak to?
To her that is not here, nor doth not hear.
Okay. I pray you, no more of this. 'Tis like the howling of Irish wolves against the sky. I will help you if I can. I would love you if I could. Tomorrow we'll meet. I will marry you, if ever I marry woman, and you will be married tomorrow. I will satisfy you, if ever I satisfy man, and you will be married tomorrow. I will content you, if what pleases you contents you, and you will be married tomorrow. As you love Rosalind to meet, as you love Phoebe to meet, and as I love no woman I will meet, farewell, I have left you command.
Oh, not fair if I live!
Nor I.
Nor I.
True, this is called the reproof valiant. If again it was not well cut, you would say, I lied.
This is called the counter check was. And so to the light circumstantial and the light event.
How often did you say his bit was not well
out? I did still have the light circumstantial, though he did not give me the light direct, so we measured swords and parted.
Could you not in now the order degrees of the light?
Oh, sir, we quarrel in print. By the book, because you have got two good manners. I will name you the degrees. The first, the tall quarters, the second, the criminal artist, the third, the replied chillers, the fourth, the reproof valley, the fifth, the cantic quarrelsome, the sixth, the light of circumstance, and the seventh, the light direct. All these you may avoid but the light direct, and you may avoid that too, but with an if. I knew in seven justices could not take up a quarrel. One of them thought the loving hip, as if you said so and I said so. So they shook hands and swore brothers. Your if is the only peacemaker, sir. Much virtue in if.
This isn't a rare fellow, my lord. Good as anything, and yet a fool.
He uses his folly at the stalking horse, and an appreciation of that he shoots his way.
Duke Frederick, hearing how every day men of great worth resorted to this forest, addressed a mighty power, which were on foot, purposely in his own conduct, to take his brother here and put him to the sword. And to the skirts of this wild wood he came, where, meeting with an old religious man, after some question with him, was converted both from his enterprise and from the world. His crown bequeathing to his banished brother, and all their lands returned to them again that were with him exiled. This to be true, I do engage my love.
Welcome, young man. Thou offerest fairly to thy brother's wedding. To one with lands for pound, other lands large and potent dukedom. First, in this forest, let us do those ends that we hear well begun and well got. And after, every of this happy number that here and do in shrewd days and nights to us shall share in the good poverty and fortune, according to the measure of their states. Meantime, forget this new fallen dignity and fall into our rustic revelry. Play music, and brides and bridegrooms all. The measure, leave to joy, it's the measure's fall.
Sir, what do you think made a religious back to play music at the pompous court? To him, I will.
she well deserves it.
You to a love that true faith is your merit. You to your love and land and great allies. You to a well-deserved bed. And you for wrangling, for loving voyage, but 2 month victualled. I'll stay away, but for dancing measures.
Wait, stay, Jacob, stay.
I see no pastime here. I'll have to stay at your abandoned cave.
Proceed, proceed. We do begin these rites, as we do trust they'll end in true delights.
Thank you.